Welcome to the life of Augustine Louis Cauchy. Augustine Louis Cauchy was born on August 21, 1789 in Paris, France. He was a French mathematician who pioneered an analysis and the theory of substitution groups. He was considered to be one of the greatest modern mathematicians. During the Reign of Terror of the French Revolution, Cauchy and his family fled Paris to a village where Cauchy met mathematician Pierre Simon Laplace and chemist Claude Louis Berthelot. On Joseph Louis Lagrange's advice, Augustin Louis was enrolled in the École Centrale de Panthéon, the best secondary school of Paris at that time, in the fall of 1802. Most of the curriculum consisted of classical languages. The young and ambitious Cauchy, being a brilliant student, won many prizes in Latin and humanities. In spite of these successes, Augustine Louis chose an engineering career and prepared himself for the entrance examination to the École Polytechnique. Cauchy became a military engineer and in 1810 went to work on the harbors and fortifications for Napoleon's English invasion fleet. He continued to produce several mathematical papers, working with Joseph Louis Lagrange and establishing a relationship between the number of edges, the number of vertices, and the number of faces of a convex polyhedron, and eventually solving Pierre de Fermat's problem on polygonal numbers. In 1813, Cauchy returned to Paris, and Lagrange and Laplace persuaded him to devote himself to mathematics. The following year, he published a memoir on definite integrals that became the basis of the theory of complex functions. From 1816, he held professorships in the Faculty of Sciences, the College de France, and the École Polytechnique, all in Paris, and soon was appointed as a professor at the Academy of Sciences. Cauchy's greatest contributions to mathematics are embodied predominantly in his three great written works: courses on analysis from the École Royale Polytechnique, resume of lessons on infinitesimal calculus, and lessons on the applications of infinitesimal calculus to geometry. The first phase of modern rigor in mathematics originated in his lectures and researches in analysis during the 1820s. Cauchy married Eloise de Burgh in 1818, who was a close relative of a publisher who was to publish most of Cauchy's work. In 1819, the couple's first daughter, Marie-Françoise Alicia, was born, and in 1823, their second and last daughter, Marie-Mathilde, was born. Cauchy's contributions to calculus included clarifying the principles of calculus and putting them on a satisfactory basis by developing them with the aid of limits and continuity, concepts now considered vital to analysis. During the same period, he developed the theory of functions of a complex variable, today indispensable in applied mathematics, from physics to aeronautics. Delta epsilon proofs are also first found in the works of Augustine Louis Cauchy. This is not always recognized, since Cauchy gave a purely verbal definition of the limit. Upon the exile of Charles VI in 1830 and the ascension of Louis-Philippe to the throne, Cauchy went into self-exile rather than take the oath of allegiance. A chair of mathematical physics was created for him at the University of Turin, but in 1833 he left to tutor the Duc de Bordeaux, grandson of Charles X. In 1838, with the suspension of the oath, he returned to France, resuming his chair at the École Polytechnique. Cauchy made substantial contributions to the theory of numbers and wrote three important papers on error theory. His work in optics provided a mathematical basis for the workable but somewhat unsatisfactory theory of the properties of ether, a hypothetical omnipresent medium once thought to be the conductor of light. His collected works, complete works by Augustine Cauchy, were published in 27 volumes. Cauchy continued with his writings and publications through the remainder of his life. It is said that his last words to the Academy were, "I will explain it in greater detail in my next memoir." He died 18 days later at the age of 68. And now we will be moving on to the proof of the sum law for limits using epsilon delta. The sum law for limits states that if limit x approaching c f of x and limit x approaching c g of x both exist, then limit x approaching c f of x plus g of x equals limit x approaching c f of x plus limit x approaching c g of x. This is often loosely stated as the limit of a sum is a sum of limits. Since we are working under an assumption that all of the limits above exist, let us suppose that limit x approaching c f of x equals L1 and limit x approaching c g of x equals L2. So we now hope to show that limit x approaching c f of x plus g of x equals L1 plus L2. Appealing to the epsilon delta definition for a limit, we must show that for any epsilon greater than 0, we can find a delta greater than 0, such that if 0 is less than absolute value x minus c, which is less than delta, then absolute value f of x plus g of x minus L1 plus L2 is less than epsilon. Let's look at what we know. We know that limit x approaching c f of x equals L1. So, again, appealing to the epsilon delta definition, only this time in reverse, we also know that for any epsilon 1 greater than 0, we can find a delta 1 greater than 0, such that if 0 less than absolute value x minus c less than delta 1, then absolute value f of x minus L1 is less than epsilon 1. We also know that limit x approaching c g of x equals L2. So, once again, appealing to the epsilon delta definition, only this time in reverse, we also know that for any epsilon 2 greater than 0, we can find a delta 2 greater than 0, such that if 0 is less than absolute value x minus c less than delta 2, then absolute value g of x minus L2 is less than epsilon 2. Consider what happens when we take both epsilon 1 and epsilon 2 to be epsilon over 2. There must consequently be a delta 1 greater than 0 and a delta 2 greater than 0. Such that if 0 less than absolute value x minus c less than delta 1, then absolute value f of x minus L1 is less than epsilon over 2. And if 0 less than absolute value x minus c less than delta 2, then absolute value g of x minus L2 is less than epsilon over 2. Suppose delta was the smaller of the two values, delta 1 and delta 2. First, notice it must be the case that delta is greater than 0, as D1 and D2 are greater than 0. Further, it should also then be true that if 0 less than absolute value x minus c less than delta, then absolute value f of x minus L1 is less than epsilon over 2, and absolute value g of x minus L2 is less than epsilon over 2. Adding the inequalities together, we find that if 0 less than absolute value x minus c less than delta, then absolute value f of x minus L1 plus absolute value g of x minus L2 is less than epsilon over 2 plus epsilon over 2, which equals epsilon. We can use the triangle inequality for absolute values, which is the absolute value of a plus b, which is less than or equal to absolute value a plus absolute value b, to discover that if 0 less than absolute value x minus c less than delta, Then, absolute value f of x minus L1 plus g of x minus L2 less than or equal to absolute value f of x minus L1 plus absolute value g of x minus L2 is less than epsilon. Finally, rearranging some terms inside one of the absolute values and removing the sum of absolute values to its right, we find that if 0 less than absolute value x minus c less than delta, then absolute value f of x plus g of x minus L1 plus L2 is less than epsilon, which is what we hope to show. Thus, limit x approaching c f of x plus g of x equals L1 plus L2. And consequently, limit x approaching c f of x plus g of x equals limit x approaching c f of x plus limit x approaching c g of x. This leads us to our review question, which is limit r approaching 9 square root r over r minus 9 to the 4th power.